I am officially back in the States. Well, I've taken about 2 days to recover from the jet lag, but this is my first time recording since I've gotten back from the UK, more specifically Swindon and the Air Tattoo, the Riyadh Air Tattoo 2016. Holy crap, fantastic experience. So how this video is going to work is that I'm going to be talking about my experience from the start to the end of the whole trip, and then I'll just flash some B-roll footage or just my favorite jets and planes of the air show. Now, I do got to apologize about my camera quality. I thought my, what is this thing called? The Canon G7X was up to the task, but really I need more zoom and I need a way to break the air from entering the microphone on the camera. So I do apologize. This was one of my first air shows that I've ever been to, so I've learned a lot and I'm going to be looking into a better video recorder in the future. All right, so let's start with the travel to London. Now, the airport that I went out of was RDU International, straight shot to London Heathrow, which was pretty awesome. So the flight was about 6 hours and 40 minutes, and the first ticket I got, or the first seat I got, didn't have power or anything. So I was like, man, dude, I really want to play some Kerbal Space Program at flight level 3-4, or maybe have Wi-Fi and stream. That probably wouldn't work, but I wanted to try it. So I contacted the airlines, or American Air. By the way, I flew on a 767-300ER, or just a 300, a pretty nice aircraft. I do say so myself. But yeah, I contacted them because there was this one seat open, 12J. And it had the power symbol and it had the Wi-Fi symbol. So I was like, yeah. But by the way, before we go any further into this video, I want to thank Curse for sending me all the way to London. They went out of their way to making this trip possible. So thank you so much, Curse. But that goes back to the original conversation on 12J or the seat. So I contacted the airlines and I made sure, I asked them, is there power on this plane? And then so they were like, yeah, there's Wi-Fi, just buy the goddamn ticket. And so I was like, all right, cool, so it's confirmed I'll have power. So I contacted Curse and they bumped me up, not to first class, because holy shit, that's like a $3,000 ticket. I was bumped up for $130 into the main cabin where the power was at. So get this, I get on the plane and I got this big grin on my face. So I'm like, haha, all you fucking peasants in the back of the plane, I got power, I got Wi-Fi, and I had additional leg room as well. So I was like, golden, this is gonna be a fantastic trip. I sit down at my seat, still with a big grin on my face. I sit down, I look for the power, you know, the 3-prong one for a laptop charger. Below the seat, there's this one square opening, and on the plastic cover of the quote-unquote power outlet, it said DC outlet. My heart sank. Oh, by the way, this is definitely a first world problem. Just first world problem. So what DC power is, you know, the adapter needed to access the DC power was the car charger one. You know, the charger that you stick in your car with the USB cable to your phone. Yeah, it was that one. So I was like, what the fuck? Why am I gonna bring a car charger onto an airplane? And then so I was kind of freaking out. I was tweeting American Airlines all bitchy and stuff, kind of over dramatic. And they're like, they responded like this. We are sorry that you did not understand the type of power we were offering. I was like, who the fuck uses DC? It makes sense as an airline company to offer DC to non-business paying customers. The business had AC, no problem. But the DC power is, it draws less from the battery. So you pay less, you draw less. Kind of, you know, you pay for what you get. Anyways, beside the point. So I'm feeling, actually that's kind of to the point, but different topic, same subject. Oh gosh, I hope you guys can follow this story. So I'm feeling really, really down. And I'm like, oh my gosh, you know, I don't have anything to charge my laptop or my phone. I only had 33% on my phone. And there was only so much time I could play Pocket Planes until I wanted to pull my hair out. So I asked nicely. This flight attendant comes across, looks at me, and I think he like sees that I'm like sad or something. And he goes, sir, do you need any help? I was like, I look up and I was like, this is probably not going to happen. You know, they're not going to have this. Do you by chance have a DC to AC converter? He was like, yeah, we do, but just don't, you know, keep it on the low. We don't have a lot of them. Do you need it? And I was like, yes, I told him I needed it. I just wanted to play a Kerbal Space Program. And so he brings this thing over. I plug it in. It starts vibrating. Like, I don't really know how those things work, but I guess it needed a fan to cool the transistors on the mother... No, I'm just kidding. But it started to make noise and stuff. So I was like, yes, man, this is going to work. The light went up. I plugged my three-pronger into it, plugged it into my laptop, and we got a charge. And I was like, yeah, we did it, you know. And then it stopped charging. Then it started charging again, and then it stopped charging. And then it started charging again, and then it stopped charging. And it started charging again. You get the point, or the picture. And so I was like, okay, well, maybe something's wrong with this specific AC to DC converter. And so I ring the flight attendant. By this point, we're already an hour into our flight, and my battery on my laptop's running really, really low, so I'm getting first world desperate right here, boys. And so I contact the nice flight attendant, and he came over, and I asked him, hey, man, do you have a different one? This one doesn't seem to be working. And he kind of looks at me strange and kind of chuckles a little bit, because I think he knew what the problem was, but he wanted me just to find out for myself. And so he goes back and gets a new charger, and I plug it in, or not a charger, an adapter, and it starts doing the same thing. Charges, stops charging. Then so I plug it out, I use the Nintendo 64 blow technique, trying to get any dust out of like the components of the adapter. And then, so while I'm trying to blow on it to like remove dust, I flip it over, and it says 100 watt DC to AC. And my hands cover my face with a facepalm. And this is horrible. Because my laptop is definitely above 100 watts. Like, to charge a laptop, I don't know, maybe you need a 400 watt power supply. Or, you know, I have an Alienware, I don't know what model it is, but it has a i7 and a GTX 970M. So it definitely needs some more power than 100 watts. So for 2 hours of me desperately trying to get power, I couldn't. So luckily enough, there was a USB charger on the AC or the DC to AC, and I was able to play fucking Pocket Planes for 6 hours and 40 minutes. So now I land in London, everything's going good. Everything's starting to look a little bit different. Let me just tell you, at Heathrow International, there are no small planes. They're huge. You got A380s. You got 787s. You got 777s. You got 767s. Sorry, my numbers are getting confused. You got 747s. There's no plane under a 737. I don't see any domestic planes or any type of like connector flights. Maybe because I was at the international terminal or the gate. But they were just huge planes. Now I was having a lot of fun checking all those planes out. So I land, or I depart, there we go, from the plane. And I catch a train to Paddington station where I was meeting up Weeby. And for some amazing reason, Weeby took about 3 hours to get to Paddington. So I'm sitting on this metal bench for 3 hours eating meat and potatoes. No, I'm just kidding. They actually had some really good fresh snacks there. And so I finally meet up with Weeby, and the first time me seeing him in the flesh, Weeby is just murdered out in the freshest clothes ever. He's got a blazer on, a t-shirt, a graphic t-shirt, jeans, and Converses. Fucking beautiful, man. And so we leave the Paddington station to Henson, to the Royal Air Force Museum. We see the Sunderland. We walk through it. We see the Lancaster, Hunter, Spitfires, Eurofighter, F-35, all in static positions, and it's a good time. Also, the British have the best BLT I've ever had. It's just like in America, they give you this really like crispy, thin bacon. And in, at least at this air museum, they had like thick, juicy cuts, man. A lot of mayonnaise. It was top notch. And I had a Spitfire beer, and I cliched and took a picture with the Spitfire beer in front of the Spitfire, dude. Facepalm. It had to be done, though. It had to be done. So it was a really nice time at the air museum. I want to thank Weeby for taking the time out of his day to come hang out and escort me and making sure that I don't get lost around London and making sure I got my train to Swindon properly and on time. So I finally make it to Swindon and meet up with Devo and his father, Paul. When I first saw Devo, the voice and face didn't match at all. Devo has this very sweet, innocent, mannered British voice, and the way he looks more of like a brute, little bulldog-ish. But over time, the voice did match the face after I got to know him a little bit. His father, Paul, is freaking hilarious, dude. He's like that cliche Brit, and I don't know what the slang term to classify him as, but he's kind of like, you fucking what, mate? But like, tone it down like 0.5%, and that was him. I could understand majority of the words coming out of his mouth, but the amount of slang he had for what he was trying to say, about a third of the time I had to say, what? 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 But after like a day or two, I was able to, I guess you could say, understand what he was saying a majority of the time. So anyways, they pick me up in their awesome hatchback. I think it's an Audi. It's pretty badass. Maybe it's not. So we go driving. And in the UK, you guys drive on the left side of the road. And you guys say that's the right way and, you know, whatever. It is nuts, man. Like, I've been to India. And even though that India and the UK traffic laws cannot be compared on any level, it kind of reminded me of India just for maybe 2 or 3 times. This is what happened, and I shit you not, because I lost my mind. There were 3 roundabouts in a row, it seemed like. And the whole point to me of what a roundabout is that you go around to get to a different road without stopping. I shit you not, this 3 roundabout thing had a road going right down the middle of all 3. And so Paul, Devo's dad, with no shits given, goes right down the middle of them at like 30 kilometers, maybe 40 kilometers an hour. And there's literally like 2 or 3 times that I thought we were going to get hit. And on top of that, Paul was looking behind at me, talking to me while he was doing this. I was like, maybe it's the jet lag. Maybe this is not happening. So we finally arrive at the air show, Riyadh 2016. And we're not staying in a hotel or anything. We are camping out behind the runway. And how Devo kind of presented it is that we would just have, you know, sleeping bags and a little tent for us to stay in. This tent was unreal. It had, you could... I'm 6'4", and I could walk into the tent, stand all the way up, not hit the top. It had accommodations fully packed to sleep 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14 people in this tent. And it's really cool because there's like a common area, and then there's pods on the left and right side of each inn that you're able to unzip and zip and close off from other people in the tent. So it was really cozy and really nice just to have that privacy. In addition to the badass tent, this was like 5-star camping. We had porta potties. I literally thought that I'd be shitting in the woods and burying it with a shovel. We even had showers camping out. Fantastic. And then on top of that, Paul, Devo's dad, cooks chicken curry for the first dinner. Like, I thought this was going to be a bare bones, you know, take 2 pieces of sticks and rub them together to get fire. But no, it was a really nice experience camping out behind the airfield. And so with all this time I've been talking, I forgot to mention about I haven't slept yet once since 8 a.m. When I woke up to do all my video work before I left the RDU airport at 5 or 6 o'clock p.m. So with my calculations, I have been up for 32 hours since I left or since I woke up in America and until I went to bed at 9 p.m. in the UK. And when I went to bed at 9 p.m., it was 4 p.m. in America. Or in North Carolina. And that's how I thought I would beat the jet lag. I would just stay up for as long as I can until it was proper time to go to bed in the UK. However, when I went to bed at 9 p.m., I only slept 7 hours. Oh my gosh. My clock was like, hey man, you gotta get up. Something's not right here. Something's not right. So finally, it's the first day of the air show. I'm super excited. I wake up way earlier than I should have. The British do breakfast hard. Super hard. Now, I don't know if we had this big breakfast just because we weren't going to eat lunch that day, but I swear to gosh that this breakfast was about 4,000 calories intake. And we had, it was the most ridiculous thing ever. Because the way I eat breakfast is I have, you know, maybe two eggs and some fruit and a coffee. You know, just something light just to get the blood going. Devo and Paul don't do it that way. We had bacon, sausage, beans, sauteed tomatoes and mushrooms, three fried eggs, and then bread. And you know when someone's serving you, right? And they bring over, let's say it's breakfast time, do you want any sausage? And you say, yeah, I'll have some sausage. They usually go with the tongs or whatever, the fork or their hands, they go, one, two, would you like any more? That didn't happen at all. Paul goes, one, two, three, four, five sausages on my plate. No questions asked at all. And at this point, it's not really like a breakfast. It's more like a eating competitions. But I hoof it down because I didn't want to get hungry later and miss any bit of the air show because I'm hungry. But we woke up so early to get to an awesome spot behind the runway or on final approach or behind the Pappy lights. Now, we didn't have tickets for the air show that day, but that was just to give us an awesome different point of view than you could have from being in the air show, because in the air show, the planes are not allowed to fly over you just for safety reasons and all that jazz. But if you're outside the air show, you know, it's your fault if the plane crashes or, you know, hurts you in any way, sort of fashion. But from this point of view, the planes would literally come right above you to touch down on the runway. It really felt like you could just reach out and touch them. And also, from where we were sitting, the planes would set up for maneuvers right there and do like full turn afterburners right above you that you wouldn't get that same view in the air show. So the day was going great. Nothing better than loving planes and watching planes and jet fighters fly right over you to land. And then something strange happened. I have never seen anything like this in my life. I witnessed the longest small talk in the history of the world. Usually in America, small talk is kind of avoided. You know, if you see somebody you know, you're like, you know, you kind of like walk in a different direction. Or if you do engage in conversation, it's very short. That's why it's called short talk. I witnessed two random strangers talk for 8 minutes about Dave. And if you're wondering who the fuck is Dave, that's exactly what the conversation was about for 8 minutes. Now, they might have known each other from past air shows or something, but to me, they looked like total strangers. This is kind of how the conversation went. Hey, mate, do you know Dave? No, I don't know Dave. No. Oh, yeah, you do. You know Dave with the visor and the polka dotted tent, and he brings his dog every year. Blah, British stuff. And the guy responds, no, I do not know Dave. And I thought that was the end of it. And the first guy asking the question mentioned Dave and motorcycles, and the guy was like, oh, yeah, Dave, yeah, I know Dave. Hell yeah, Dave, yeah. 5 minutes later. Yeah. How's that bloke doing? Dave. And I shit you not, it goes on for another minute of Dave, yeah, I know him. Until something they say makes them think that they're not originally talking about the same Dave. So for the next 2 minutes, they're trying to see if they know the same Dave. And at the end of the conversation, they're both talking about the wrong Dave. And they walk off to their own lives, and I'm just sitting there fucking confused as shit as why anyone would spend 8 minutes trying to narrow down who the fuck is Dave. Anyways, it's the end of the air show. We pack up our stuff, we head back to camp, and I'm as tired as all get out. I thought I could beat jet lag, but I couldn't at all. It's around 3 p.m. in the day, and so I head into the tent to take maybe an hour nap. It's the craziest nap of my entire life. Now, I sometimes lucid dream. Sometimes. Maybe once every 2 or 3 months. I had the amount of lucidosity, that's a new word, I had in that dream was amazing. I could smell, I could touch, I could control, I could hear, I could see, you know, those are the basics. But bottom line, I could do anything I wanted to in that dream. I had that power. For some reason, my brain chose to play soccer against animals in Cambodia. It was the fucking craziest dream of my life. I had a lot of fun in that. And I woke up, and it wasn't too late, and it was time for dinner. And so we ate supper, went to bed, and then we woke up on Saturday for the main Squeeze air show. This is the day that we had tickets to go inside. And on that day, I met up with Dr. Cola Bottle and Jack Scott. Those guys are pretty cool. Jack looks like a 13-year-old, and Cola Bottle was wearing a badass fedora. But we had a really good time with each other. It was really good to see everybody in the flesh. The air show was phenomenal. On Saturday, the clouds really cleared, and a lot of the pilots were able to do their high altitude show instead of the low one. The low one, they kind of have to stay horizontal, but with the high altitude, they can start doing loops and other crazy maneuvers. But my favorite moments of the air show were, one, seeing the F-35 hovering above the runway. And what blew my mind about the F-35 is that I thought it would kind of sway left and right while it was hovering. I had no idea it was that stable with its hovering mode on. And it was really, really windy out, but I assumed that the computer system on board is able to recognize different forces against the hovering mode and it counters it very quickly. But that thing stayed rock solid still. It blew my mind. The second thing was the F-22 defying fucking gravity. For a good portion of its show, it really wasn't flying. It was just like somehow staying in the air with its engines and its vectored thrust. Next was the Eurofighter Typhoon. That jet was, in my opinion, the loudest jet out of the whole air show display. That thing pierced my ears. It hurt so bad. Additionally, the Eurofighter Typhoon could turn on a dime. That thing had probably the best turn radius of any fighter out there, at least who displayed its turn radius. And the last thing was the Mirage 2000. There were actually two of them, and this was actually on the last day of the air show, but this was one of my favorite moments, is the commentary guy was saying that this is the last time that these two pilots will ever fly together or for an air show. And so me and Devo looked at each other, we're like, they're gonna break the sound barrier, because you're not supposed to break the sound barrier at all for an air show, because first it can damage eardrums, it can break car windows, it can set off car alarms, and it can shatter windows on residential houses. And long behold, on their last pass, one of the Mirage 2000s broke the sound barrier. And how it worked, the plane was like right in front of you, but you did not hear its anything yet. And all of a sudden, once it kind of passed you, for about, you know, a half a second, all of a sudden, yep, that's what a sonic boom sounds like. And then me and Devo turned around and gave each other a high five. We were hyped as shit. And then, so that was pretty much the end of the air show. The third day, we kind of sat at our campsite and drank some brews, and we were seeing Jack off to his train because he only stayed for one day. We made a Fly Daily Tries British Foods video. And so that video will probably come out on the weekend. I try blood pudding, pickled eggs, this yeast stuff or Vegemite or Megamite. I don't know. They eat some really great stuff. And then after Jack left, me, Devo, Cola, and Paul had a dinner, had some more brews. I went to bed and I had to wake up at 5:55 at 4 o'clock to catch a bus that would bring me to the airport in time for my 9:30 flight, which was delayed but wasn't too bad. And so I got back to the States around 2:10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, and the rest is history. So guys, I hope you have enjoyed this video. I definitely talked more than 7 or 8 minutes. I had a lot to share with you guys, and I hope you were able to see a little bit into my travels into London, and I hope to be going to more air shows in the future. My next air show on my list that I want to attend to is the MAK, M-A-K, I believe. It's a Russian air show, and they have PAC-FUZ and SU-30-somethings and MiG 29s and flankers and super flankers, and I would, you know, I'm pretty excited about the Russian jets as it is. Hopefully they'll have a MiG-15 or MiG-9 late. We'll just have to wait and see. But guys, I hope you have enjoyed this video, and have a great day. Until next time, peace out.